Lift up your voice and pray that prayer before God. More of you, Lord, in my life. Asito ruseli alabaradusa. Mekluto shekleto. More of you, Lord. I need more of you, Jesus. The more I love you, the more I want to know you more. Jesus, increase in my life that I may decrease. Let the I in me decrease and let the God in me increase. Blessed be your name, Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Father, our eyes look unto you. Visit us with your word. Let the transforming power of your word be released unto us in the name of Jesus. Speak unto us. Open our eyes. Give us understanding. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name. And let the redeemer of the Lord say so. Put your hands together for Jesus. Please, you may be seated. Hallelujah. If you are blessed by that wonderful ministration from the choir, I'd like you to put your hands together for Jesus. More of God is less of man. He said that he might increase, that I might decrease. Until the I in you decreases, the God in you cannot increase. Until the flesh in you decreases, the God in you cannot increase. And that's why Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. The life I live by faith in the Son of God who died for me. I am crucified with Christ. Philippians 1:21. Hallelujah. Until that selfish nature of man decreases, the godly nature in man cannot increase. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. In Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, hallelujah, he said, I'm crucified with Christ. That selfish nature in me is dead, and that's why the godly nature in me can come alive. Once more, you are blessed by that ministration. Put your hands together for Jesus. Hallelujah. On behalf of God's servants, I'd like to welcome every one of us to this special communion service. And I trust God that God will be speaking to you. And there's going to be transformation in your life today in the name of Jesus. Just one word from God brings about transformation. May that word, that your word, comes to you today in the name of Jesus. That amen is not loud enough for a blessing. Our prophetic theme for the month is godliness is profitable unto all things. Godliness is profitable unto all things. And our teaching topic is exercise yourself unto godliness. Part 1C. Exercise yourself unto godliness. We had powerful shots in the first and second services. I'd like to encourage you to pick the tape. It will be a great blessing unto you in the name of Jesus. Exercise yourself unto godliness. 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 7. 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 7. But refuse profane and old wife fables, and exercise thyself rather unto godliness. Verse 8. Bodily exercise profited little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is, and that which is to come. Hallelujah. Let's read another scriptures. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verses 19. To 21. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verses 19 to 21. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure. Having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. And let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Hallelujah. Let everyone that nameth the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. Exercise thyself unto godliness. Exercise thyself unto godliness. One more scriptures. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 to 27. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 to 27. There is power in reading God's word, because the letter killeth, it is the spirit that gives life. God's word is spirit and life. Know ye not that they will run in a race, run on, but only one receiveth the prize. So run that ye may obtain. And every man that strives for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now, they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly. So fight I, not as one that beateth the air. Verse 27. But I keep under my body, and I bring it into subjection, lest that by enemies, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a cast away. That shall not be your portion. That amen is too weak. Shout it as if you are the only one in this service. Exercise thyself unto godliness. God's people, I'd like you to know that life is a race of purpose that positions us for divine blessing. I run not as uncertainly. I therefore so fight, not like one that beaten they are. I keep my body under subjection, so that by enemies, after I have preached to people, I will not be a castaway. Hallelujah. Life is a race, and heaven is our destination. If you know your destination, it now informs how you run the race. It is a life of purpose. So many people participate in athletics competition for so many reasons. Some people go there to win. Other people just go there to show face. But those who go there to win, there are certain rules and regulations they abide by. Why? Because they have a goal. They have something in focus. A good athlete that is going for the gold medal, he doesn't do anything anyhow. He doesn't eat anyhow. Praise the name of the Lord. As a matter of fact, he does not just dress anyhow. And that's why athletes, they dress the lightest so as to get to the destination gloriously. You will never find an athlete wearing an army boot to run. Praise the name of the Lord. No. You will never find an athlete carrying raincoats, the heavy one, to go for athletics competition and carry rain boot. And they say, on your marks, is battling with the boot. No. They have specific dressings. Everything is light. Their shoes is a spike shoe. It's not for guy. It is for purpose to get them to their destination. Life is a race. Christianity is a race with a purpose. And the destination is heaven. And those who want to get there, they run the race with precision. Praise the name of the Lord. And Paul said, I so run, not uncertainly. I put my body under suggestion to stop anything that wants to stop me to get to my destination. I am running a race to meet my Redeemer. I am running a race to meet my Redeemer. Heavenly race, heavenly race, heavenly race to meet my Redeemer.
It's a race that has its destination as eternity.
And therefore, it requires precision.
This Christian race, when it is run well, it delivers to us blessing in the now and eternity in the future.
Praise the name of the Lord. And that's why it says in 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 7, godliness is profitable unto all things. 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 7, exercise yourself rather unto godliness. Verse 8, 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 8, for bodily exercise is profitable little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is. It promises us blessing indeed in the present now, and also in the world to come. It guarantees for us a place in eternity.
Anyone, therefore, that will run a successful race, you must be careful what you carry. And that's why in Hebrews chapter 4 and verses 1 to 2,
Hebrews chapter 12 and verses 1 to 2, Hebrews chapter 12 and verses 1 to 2, wherefore, seeing also that we are compassed about with such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us, this glorious race, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Let's look and run the way he ran, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. What looks like shame and mockery today, he endures, he despises shame. They will mock you, brother winner, sister, from glory to glory. He despised all the shame. No wonder he ended up in glory. Hallelujah.
Let us lay aside every weight, every sin that easily beset us. Let us run and run properly.
Not all that are running well. And it is only those who run well that will win the prize. He says, you have run well, but who hindered you from obeying the rules? In athletics, you may come first. If you break the rules, you don't win the prize. He say, run on your lane. They give you instruction. Wait until they're gone before you move. If you say it's not necessary, I want to run it the way I want, and you go, they will leave you. You run the fastest and you get there, they push you aside and take somebody else. That's not going to be your portion.
Let us lay aside every weight of sin. No one is running and carries one bag of cement on the head. He may not arrive. He may start, but he may not finish. Let's lay aside the weight. All those malice, all those backbiting, all those slandering, all those cheating. Let's lay it aside. They await. If you don't stop it, they may stop you from getting to your destination. But today, by the power of God, every weight that is trying to contest your destination in Christ, it shall be destroyed in the name of Jesus. Let us lay aside and let us run the race. Let us lay aside and run the race. Sin is a sinker. It's a stopper. It's a destroyer. Don't let it destroy your destiny. God's blessing is not just for everybody. Sometimes his mercy makes it get to everybody, but it won't always be to everybody. For the godly, in Psalm 5 and verse 12, Psalm 5 and verse 12, and the Lord shall bless the righteous. With favor shall thou compass him with a shield. For thou, O Lord, will bless the righteous. Thou, O Lord, will bless the godly. Not everybody. Hallelujah. In Psalm 112, verses 1 to 3. Psalm 112 and verses 1 to 3. The Bible says, praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord. Not everybody. The man that feareth the Lord. Take notes. That delighted greatly in his commandment. Not take his commandment for granted. The one that feareth the Lord. The one that takes his commandment seriously. His seed shall be mighty upon the earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. Wealth and riches shall be in his house, and his righteousness endureth forever. Hallelujah. Righteousness does not stop you from being blessed. Praise the name of the Lord. In fact, it is what commands more blessing. His righteousness endureth. Wealth does not corrupt righteousness. No. The man that feareth the law, that greatly delight in his commandment, he said, that man, God's eyes will be turned continuously to him. In Psalm 92 and verse 12, Psalm 92 and verse 12, the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like cedar in Lebanon. Can you see? The righteous. Oh, godliness carries great profit. Profit of all things. Make up your mind to live right. Your liftings, your promotions, your elevation is a function of your purity. Jesus was exalted. He was lifted above all his fellows. Why? Because of his righteousness. The more righteous you are, the more pure you are, the higher you rise. In Psalm 45 and verses 6 and 7. Psalm 45 and verses 6 and 7. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of your kingdom is a right scepter. Thou lovest righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, thy God, has anointed thee with the oil of gladness above all your fellows. The more you love righteousness, will influence the way you hate wickedness. You can't love righteousness and hate wickedness at the same time. No. Anyone that loves righteousness is always against anything that is unrighteous. Thou lovest righteousness. Again, you hate iniquity. Therefore, you know, when we were in secondary school, they give you a question. You say, if A is equal to B and B is equal to C, therefore A is equal to C. Praise the name. So you can tell where a righteous man will end. When you see a lover of righteousness, you will know what he can do. Naturally speaking, he will hate iniquity. He will hate wickedness. And therefore, no Satan can keep that person down. He lifted Jesus above his fellow. Righteousness exalts, sin brings down. And that's why the greatest battle in the life of a man is the battle against sin. It's a battle against sin. The only validation of our redemption is our dominion over sin. How do you show you are redeemed? Dominion over sin. Sin shall not have dominion over you. Romans chapter 6 and verse 14. Romans chapter 6 and verse 14. Hallelujah. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. The only validation of our redemption is our dominion over sin. The only way we can prove that we are passed from death to life is by living a godly life. You are not a Christian by your name. You are not a Christian by your church attendance, even though they are good. You are not a Christian by your much activity in the church. All Christians supposedly go to church. But it's not all those who go to church that are Christian. Your only validation for redemption is your lifestyle, your godly lifestyle. Your godly lifestyle. And that's what gives us a place in eternity. You know, he said, on that day, some people will come and say, Master, we preach in your name. He said, good, yes. Everybody can preach. Even the devil can preach. We healed in your name. We performed miracles in your name. He said, yes. Good. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. So if you mention my name, naturally, the miracles can happen. He said, but I will say unto them, depart from me, thou workers of iniquity. I know thee not. They did all the good works, but unfortunately, there was nothing reflective in their life. Praise the name of the Lord. The only thing that gives you and I a place in eternity is our godly lifestyle. Praise the name of the Lord. It's our godly lifestyle. So I'd like you to begin to live your life with eternity in view. He said, on that day, I will say, I know you are in three units. Very good. I know you have a very good name. Peter, James. And your father's name is Peter. So it's Peter Square. Peter, we say unto them, your lifestyle does not agree with those who are in this kingdom. Depart from me. Because of a life of sin. So stop that sin that is striving to stop you. He wants to stop your blessing in this world and stop you from the glorious place that God has reserved for you for eternity. But he won't succeed. In the name of Jesus, by the word of God now, I decree power to overcome that sin. In the name of Jesus, every weight that is easily besetting you, everything that is polluting your Christian walk, today receive victory over them in the name of Jesus. How do I therefore overcome temptations? What are the practical steps to overcoming temptation? Because the enemy comes to man through temptation. The enemy's weapon in taking man away from God is through temptations. How do I therefore overcome temptations? Number one, engage in scheduled prayer. Engage in scheduled prayer. So you must schedule your lifestyle. Live a lifestyle of prayer. That's what we are saying. Not just to attend prayer meeting once in a while. When you are looking for promotion, throughout that week you are there, you don't miss any prayer. But after that, what happened? Have a personal schedule of prayer, targeting a lifestyle of holiness. That is, you have a scheduled time. If it is 30 minutes, if it is 20 minutes, if it is 1 hour, all that you are praying for, Lord, empower me with the spirit of holiness. Lord, purify me. Lord, every debris in my life that may want to make me walk against your will, Father, by the blood, cleanse me. Cleanse me. That is a specific time you dedicate to God for sanctification prayers that will keep you walking in tract with God. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 6. When you pray in secret, the Lord who sits in secret will hear you. And in Matthew chapter 6 verses 10 to 13, when you pray kingdom prayers, pray that the kingdom will come. His will be done in your life. Pray that he will forgive you as you forgive other people. Pray that he will not lead you into temptation, because you want to live a godly life. He should give you power to excel. Pray specific and targeted prayer. Schedule prayer of sanctification for your life. Pray in the spirit. When you pray in the spirit, the Holy Spirit helps you to pray well. He knows the areas of your life that is not pleasing to God. So he goes into that area and opens it to God for purification and sanctification. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 3 verses 11 to 12. When you begin to pray in the spirit, the Holy Spirit takes over, gather all the filthy areas of your life and set it ablaze with unquenchable fire. Praise the name of the Lord. Romans 8, 26, 27. We know not how to pray as we ought to, but the Holy Ghost prays with us with deep groanings which cannot be uttered. Romans 8, 26 to 27. Number two, on how practical steps to overcome temptation. Engage in daily word shower. The word of God is a cleanser. The word of God is a purifier. The words have I hid in my heart. that I will not sin against you. The word of God kept in your heart prevents you from a life of sin. Hallelujah. Psalm 119 and verse 11. Your word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against you. The word of God keeps you away from sin. In Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 26, the word of God cleanses you. It's a cleanser. That he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. So when you inject God's word into your life, it keeps you clean. It keeps you from the pollution of the world. Hallelujah. In Psalm 119 and verse 130, the entrance of his word giveth light and giveth understanding to the simple. Psalm 119 and verse 130, the entrance of the word gives light. Where there is light, there cannot be darkness. So the light inside of you shatters every darkness each time the enemy is coming with an evil thought, which is darkness, because of the word of God that you have ingested into your heart. It disperses it. It can't stay. When God's word is fired into your heart, you don't struggle with sin. Number three, purge yourself from carnalities. Purge yourself from carnalities. Examine yourself each time. Purge yourself. Don't let your heart be habitation of stoning evil. Purge yourself from every evil works. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 19 to 21. In a great house, there are not only vessels of gold, but silver, but of wood, of clay. If any man therefore purges himself, he will be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, and made for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. God wants to walk with you. God wants to walk through you. But God will only walk through a sanctified vessel. And that's why the more you purge yourself from all these things, the more God entrusts into your hands assignment. The more God uses you. The more God finds a dwelling place in your life. My body is a sanctuary. Purify me, Lord, like silver and gold. To make my body a sanctuary where God can dwell. God cannot dwell in a dirty vessel. No, he only dwells in a sanctified vessel. And when God dwells in you, then you enjoy all of his manifestation. Purge yourself. Purge yourself consistently. Hallelujah. Accept personal responsibility. Purge yourself. It is when you accept personal responsibility that establishes your destiny in a grand style. Hallelujah. Number four. Make no provision for the flesh. Romans 13 and verse 14. Make no provision for the flesh, which means don't give opportunity to the flesh. Put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ. Make not provision for the flesh. Don't give the flesh any attention, any opportunity to fulfill the lust which it has. Don't give the flesh any opportunity. Don't give the flesh any opportunity. Don't tempt yourself. Don't tempt yourself. Don't do anything that will spark up that lust of the flesh. Don't tempt yourself. You were a drunkard before Jesus saved you. What are you still doing among drunkards? Every day you sit in their midst. You may not drink the first day, but something is happening. The devil is working on your mind. You were a smoker before. What are you still doing among smokers? These are the things that made some people to go back to their vomit. What are you still doing? What are you still doing? Don't give opportunity to the flesh. Don't give opportunity to the flesh. Those dirty magazines that you read, for what? Are there not things that pollute your mind and make you begin to think of the things you have left before? You know the reason why some people are born again and yet nothing has changed in their life is because they have not mortified the flesh. They still feed the flesh with the things the flesh like. They watch things they shouldn't watch. They read things they shouldn't read. They go to places they shouldn't. So even though they are claimed to be born again, but nothing has changed in their life. And if nothing has changed in your life since when you claim to give your life to Jesus, then something is wrong. I know we used to sing a song before.
The things I used to do, I do them no more. The things I used to do, I do them no more. The things I used to do, I do them no more. There is a great change since I'm born again. There is a great change since I'm born again. There is a great change since I'm born again. There is a great change since I'm born again. There is a great change since I'm born again. What are the changes? Count it. If there is no any visible change, then it means that you are not putting yourself. It means you are not doing anything about your spiritual life. Make no provision for the flesh. Drop those things that were there before. Stop going to where you used to go. Stop reading what you used to read. Stop watching the things you used to watch. When everybody is asleep, what do you watch in your house? You are a child of God. What are you still keeping in your... What is that whiskey doing in your wardrobe? You say because it's Harmattan season. Just to warm up the body. The Holy Ghost is not enough for you to warm. And in the night you wake up, when everybody is asleep, you take the bottle again. And put... Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Make no provision for the flesh. You say, after all, it's small. If it is before, that bottle, it can't last me for 2 days. But I thank God, since I gave my life to Jesus, at least that bottle, sometimes 1 week. Praise the name of the Lord. Give no provision for the flesh. Number 5. There are certain things you must flee to escape from. One must flee to escape. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 18. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 18. There are things you must flee from. You must know what to flee from. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committed fornication sinneth against his own body. Flee. Did you see that word? Flee. 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 You know the account of Joseph in Genesis chapter 39. His master's wife caught him. Today is today. You must lie with me. Joseph said, never. I fear God. He ran. She caught his garment. Joseph said, it's better to run out naked than to go to hell. It's better for me to be ashamed. I mean, men to be ashamed of me here than God to be ashamed of me. He ran, he flee from his life. Praise the name of the Lord. Earlier on, in the second teaching, in the second service, it was mentioned that some people, you now go and camp yourself with a woman and say you are strong. You are strong? Samson was a strong man, but you know how he ended. Samson, what's the secret of your power? Until when his destiny crash on the laps of a woman. Don't play with sin. Flee. There are things you must not wait to see the second time. Flee. You know the Bible says in another portion we are soon going to read. It says resist the devil and the devil shall flee. But there is a place that it says flee. You are supposed to flee. If you resist the devil, there are sometimes you resist the devil and he will flee. But there are sometimes it is you that will flee. If he refuses to flee, you run for your life. Praise the name of the Lord. As a young lady, why do you choose each time to go and visit that man? The only time you go to visit is in the night. Say, you know, I'm very busy during the day. That's why. You're now visiting a man who is single, who has only one bed in his house that is 6 inches. You visit him by 9 p.m. And the man goes and says, I think you need to eat. He puts beans on fire. Hallelujah. That we get cooked in the next 1.5 hours. And by the time the beans is done,
It is already to 12. He said, that's your house. I heard that some ritual killers killed some people yesterday. It's a dangerous place. Why don't you wait and go early morning? He said, no, but I think it's dangerous. And here you are, face to face. That's when you begin to pray one dry tongue. Oh God, I receive strength. There is no strength. There is no wisdom in that. Praise the name of the Lord. Flee! Escape for your life. Joseph ran! And that's why he got the crown at the end. He ran for his life. Flee. 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 You are in a relationship. Don't say, after all, we are going to get married. What is there? And what is there? There's no problem. We are getting married now. No problem. There is problem. There is problem. That's why many ladies have been victims. You now run to pastor. He deceived me. He deceived me. The man has carried everything he needs in you. He now tell you God didn't say so again. Praise the name of the Lord. Flee! Don't play with your life. When you are talking to a man and he's touching you anyhow, don't stay there and be laughing like a sheep. And your body is doing gri-gri. And you are still there. Praise the Lord. You react. I'm sorry. Please don't touch me like that. I'm sorry. I have to go now. Don't stay there and be smiling. He said, I hope you're all right. Yes, I thank God. From glory to glory. That's my name. You run for your life because you may not be able to contain what is going next. Flee. Number 6. He said, resist the devil from molesting you. James chapter 4 verse 7. James chapter 4. There are some things you can resist. Submit yourself therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. You see, resistance to the devil does not come automatically. The level of your submission to God determines the resistance you have against the devil. You can't be playing careless Christian life and you think you have any resistance. Prayer life weak. Word life zero. You treat God anyhow. Service, you only come when you like. Even when you come, half of the time you are chatting outside. It's only when it's time for communion, you go, let's go and shack the thing again. Not serious with God. It's your level of submission to God that determines the resistance to the devil in your life. Resist the devil and he shall flee. And 7, watch the company you keep. Very importantly, watch the company that you keep. This is the undoing of many people. The undoing of many people. Some people are sincere, but because of wrong company, they live a life of mess. You just heard the testimony we heard from that brother. He said, I didn't know how I got myself into this mess. How that suddenly I now saw myself as an armed robber. Because of the kind of people I was keeping. Listening to me, God's people. Your friend will always determine your end. Be careful. Be careful. Be not deceived. Evil communication corrupts good manners. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 33. Be not deceived. Don't say you are strong. I know myself. He said, be not deceived. Don't deceive yourself. You may come from a very good background. You may come from a very good family. You may come from a sound Christian home. But if you mix yourself with wrong association, your destiny is at risk. Be not deceived. There is no strong man. There is only a strong God. Watch your association. For blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinner, nor sit in the scornful. In the seat of the scornful, his delight is in the law. And in the law does he meditate day and night. He shall be like a river that is planted. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. That's the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. The man that is found in a wrong, that's a man who is not found in a wrong association. Where you are found is what determines what finds you. So be careful who you call your friend. Anyone that does not have value for spiritual things should not be your friend. Anyone that mocks your God cannot be your friend. Anyone that despises the scriptures in your life cannot be your friend. You are coming to church. That's the place you will pass through before getting home. And all that you have had, they water it down. Bro. Have they not started ordaining pastors in your church? I think you should be one of the pastors. This, your Bible is very big. Brother Winner, Sister Shiloh, they mock everything and you are still there. And it comes to a point that you cannot speak anymore because they keep mocking you. You are ashamed. That's not a place you should be found. Where do you take counsel from concerning your family? The one who has chased his wife, who has concubine around, that's the one you call your friend that you take counsel from and go to take counsel concerning issues of your family. My wife is behaving like this. I don't understand. Now, what do you think I should do? And he looks at you. That's how that my first wife started. When I slap her, they don't hear word. Women don't hear word. You need some extra thing. That's the one you are taking counsel from. Where is the place of scriptures in your life? How can you live a godly life? Every matter about your husband, you go and open it out in the to the open to those who have no value for family. How can you live a godly life? Watch the company you keep. If you want to live right, keep a right company. Your friend determines your end. May the Lord give you understanding. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. The greatest struggle is with sin. But thank God. Except a man be in Christ, you can't have dominion over sin. That's why Jesus died. Jesus knew that it takes more than just good resolution to overcome sin. He had to shed his blood. Because this sin question is a canker worm. So Jesus had to die. He had to spill his blood so that we can be eternally free from sin. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Indestructible life. Life of dominion against sin. Life of victory against sin. I know somebody is here today. You have been coming to church, but you are not in touch with Jesus. I'd like you to give me this opportunity. I will pray a very simple prayer with you. And you will be connected to Jesus. And you will live struggle free from sin. The things that that used to pull you before, that after you sin, you start crying, oh God, this kind of life is not good. You are sincere, but you need help. And that's why Jesus is here this morning to help you. Give him your hands and he will help you. And some other people are here born again, but you have been struggling and struggling with sin. Since the first day you took a wrong step, your life started going down. And you look at yourself, Satan keeps telling you, better don't call yourself a Christian. He begins to condemn you and condemn you. Return to Jesus today. Tell Jesus, I'm sorry. I have sinned, but I am returning back. He will accept you. The same way he accepted that prodigal son, he will accept you and he will receive you and he will give you power to live a righteous life. If you are among these two categories that I've mentioned, please give me this opportunity. I want to pray with you. I can see Jesus' hand wide open now, waiting to receive somebody. Be the first person he will receive. Take your Bible, your bag, wherever you are. You want to give your life to Jesus. You want to reconcile with Jesus. I don't care how far you have gone. You are not so bad. Jesus will receive you. If he received that, our brother, and now he's bubbling in Christ, he will receive you. God bless you. From wherever you are, come quickly, come quickly. Make sure you are not the last person. As I'm speaking now, the Holy Ghost is speaking to you. Today is your day of salvation. Don't say no to Jesus. God bless you. Come quickly, come quickly. Thank you. Church, let's celebrate them. They are coming, they are coming. Come quickly, come quickly, come quickly. The angels of God are rising up now because of you. Because your life needs to be redirected. Don't miss your way again. Jesus is here. God bless you. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. Jesus is waiting for you. Come quickly. Don't procrastinate. Today is your day of salvation. Today is your day of salvation. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. Jesus is waiting for you. Come quickly. Your sins will be forgiven. You will start a newness of life. Come quickly. God bless you. God bless you. I'm waiting for you. God bless you. Church, let me clap for them the more. Some people are still sitting down. Some are still wondering, should I get up? Should I not? Rise up. Rise up. Jesus is waiting for you. Rise up. Jesus is waiting for you. Today is a memorable day for you. You are backslidden for this number of years. But today is your day of salvation. What a glorious decision it will be to cross into 2017 as a godly saint. Come quickly, I'm waiting for you. God bless you. All those in front, congratulations. I'm so excited by this decision you have taken. And this is the greatest decision that you will take. And that's why the great God must reciprocate back in blessing in your life. Bow your head. Put your right hand on your chest and pray this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you today. I realize I'm a sinner, but you died for me. You forgave me of my sins. You washed me with your blood. Jesus, my heart is open now. Come into my heart. I believe you in my heart, and I confess you with my mouth. Be my Lord and my Savior. Lord, I'm returning back to you today. I have gone astray before, but I'm returning back to you. Thank you for receiving me. Thank you for restoring me. Keep me, Lord. I will not go back again. I say bye-bye to the world. I say bye-bye to sin. And I receive you. Thank you for receiving me. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Bow your head, let me pray with you now. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for this precious soul that you have received today. I ask that you keep them. I put a seal over them from henceforth, Satan. You have no portion in this life. These ones will serve the living God. In the name of Jesus, receive grace to walk with God until that day when the trumpet shall sound. You will be among the number in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name.